You're watching Tag TV. You're watching Tag TV.
Welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Indian security forces continue to eliminate Pakistan-backed terrorists in Kashmir. Don't divide terror into categories, says India at UN General Assembly. And Taliban continue to claim more territory as fighting heats up in Afghanistan. Terrorists sponsored by Pakistan's secret services and its army are putting their best efforts to create chaos and unrest in Jammu and Kashmir. But alert Indian forces have been foiling all their attempts with their preemptive measures against any terror-related violence being planned in the backyards of Islamabad. This week, the Indian security forces neutralized at least five terrorists belonging to Pakistan-based Lashkar-e-Taiba and Hizbul Mujahideen, who were attempting to inflict damage upon Indian security forces and the civilians. We have a report.
Security forces eliminated four terrorists in Kashmir in two separate encounters this week belonging to Pakistan-based terror outfit Lashkar-e-Taiba. Earlier, the oldest top commander of Hizbul Mujahideen, Mehrazuddin Halwai, who was responsible for misusing social media for terrorist activities, was gunned down recently in Kashmir's Handwara district. Last week too, five Lashkar-e-Taiba terrorists, including its district commander Nishaz Lon, were neutralized in South Kashmir's Pulwama region. Meanwhile, the Indian Army informed that Pakistan made its first infiltration attempt on the line of control after the February 25 agreement of maintaining a ceasefire along the border between India and Pakistan. However, Indian security forces successfully foiled the infiltration bid and eliminated two Pakistani terrorists and recovered one AK-47 rifle, four magazines, two hand grenades, and a huge cache of arms and ammunition along the LOC. Meanwhile, two Indian security personnel also lost their lives during the fight against Pakistani terrorists.
वहाँ खबर था कि लश्कर-ए-तैयबा के दो टेररिस्ट आज इसको एनएच पे अटैक करना था तो आर्मी और कुलगांव पुलिस ने मिलकर एक एम्बुश लगाया और एम्बुश में दोनों टेररिस्ट मारे गए दोनों लोकल टेररिस्ट है और एलईटी से तारुक रखते हैं दूसरा था पुलवामा के खबर आया था पुच्छल एक विलेज है वहाँ भी खबर था कि दो टेररिस्ट है तो वहाँ पर पुलिस सीआरपी आर ने मिलकर कोडन डालने के बाद उन्होंने सरेंडर करने कहा गया दोनों मिलिटेंट सरेंडर नहीं किया बाद में अंदर से फायरिंग आया फायरिंग का जवाब दिया गया उस इनकाउंटर में दोनों टेररिस्ट मारे गए ये दोनों भी लोकल टेररिस्ट है और से रखते हैं वास्ता
पाकिस्तान बैक्ड लश्कर-ए-तैयबा हैज ऑफ लेट स्टेप्ड अप ऑपरेशंस इन जम्मू एंड कश्मीर ऑन 27 जून 2021 Terrorists carried out a first-ever drone attack on Jammu Indian Air Force Station. As per the initial investigations, Lashkar-e-Taiba or its offshoot group, the resistant group, could be behind these attacks. Following the threat of drones, security forces in Kashmir are facing a new challenge on the military front, that is the presence of hybrid militants who are not listed as ultras, but persons radicalized enough to carry out a terror strike and then slip back into the normal routine life.
The problem is that today we should expect anything from Pakistan because Pakistan is still carrying out General Ziaul-Huq's policy of 1,000 cuts and now they have now come on to be using all these artificial intelligence equipment and drones because it saves them the think of sending a militant physically over there and then being identified, because once the militant is killed, he'll be identified that this man came from Pakistan. And that is what is the problem with Pakistan today.
Over the past few weeks, the attacks on soft targets in the Kashmir Valley, including in Srinagar, have witnessed a spike, and most of the incidents have been carried out by such pistol-bone youth who are not listed as militants with the security agencies. This new trend has sent security agencies into a tizzy, as these hybrid militants or part-time militants are very difficult to track and pose a severe challenge. According to security officials, this is happening in the valley on the directions of Pakistan's ISI. As Kashmir is heading towards more peace and prosperity, Pakistan, being envious of this development, is busy hatching wily plots to incite terrorism in the valley. They are now modifying their methods by targeting innocent civilians and political leaders without protection. Their aim is to target and silence the voices that are speaking against Pakistan's agenda of separatism and perpetrators of violence. Such attacks have witnessed a spike in the last few months. On June 27, terrorists shot dead a special police officer along with his wife and daughter in Pulwama district at his home. On June 23, terrorists shot dead a 25-year-old shopkeeper, Umar Ahmed, outside his shop in Srinagar. Before that, on June 22, terrorists killed Inspector Parvez Ahmed Dar of the CID wing of the Jammu and Kashmir Police in Kanipura, Naugam, on the outskirts of Srinagar. Earlier on 2nd June, a front of the Lashkar-e-Taiba claimed responsibility for the killing of a municipal councillor and a Kashmiri Pandit, Rakesh Pandita. These terrorist attacks are meant not only to cause large-scale damage to life and property, but also to create an atmosphere of fear and terror among the people of Jammu and Kashmir.
Moving on, the future of Afghanistan seems to be trapped in uncertainty. The Taliban insurgency is gaining momentum, with almost one-third of 421 districts or district centers in Afghanistan under its control. As the US and NATO forces are leaving the country, the insurgent group has intensified its offensive against the government. This time, the Taliban's military offensive is focused on the northern districts, far away from their southern strongholds, and several provincial capitals are under threat. Several observers believe that Afghanistan is on the path to civil war. A report. The United States began a war in 2001 with an aim to rid Afghanistan of Al-Qaeda's threat and topple Taliban's regime. Weeks after, the Al-Qaeda killed at most 3,000 people in the 9/11 terror attacks. Nearly 20 years later, Afghanistan is on the verge of going back to where it all started, into the hands of Taliban. Violence has been raging throughout Afghanistan. The weeks since US President Joe Biden announced the complete withdrawal of its troops by September 11, with intra-Afghan talks stuttering, Taliban has captured almost 200 districts of Afghanistan. In the latest move, the Taliban claim to have entered and captured Kalai-Nor, the first regional capital to face an all-out offensive by it. The Afghan government has flown in its commandos to push back the Taliban and take control of the provincial capital in northwestern Badghis province.
همکنون که ما با شما صحبت میکنم ما در شهر غرنه حضور داریم رهبری بخش از رهبری امنیتی ما در شهر غرنه حضور دارن میخوام اطمینان بدم که تمام نیروهای امنیتی و دفاعی ما به شمول قطعات خاص و اسپیشال فورس از شهر غرنه دفاع میکنن و دشمن همکنون که با ما درگیر است در بعضی از نقاط شهر هم برش تلفات وارد شده و هم به شکست مواجه شده آخرین حرف ما ایست برای فعلا که خونسردی خود حفظ کنیم انشاءالله ما قول میتونم که ما همه با هم در کنار هم انشاءالله شهر غرنه دفاع خواهیم کرد
Amid the rapid territorial gains made by the Taliban over the last 2 months, Afghan forces look helpless, left alone, to defend themselves after being abandoned by the US forces. According to the Tajik Border Guard Service, more than 1,000 Afghan security personnel fled across the border into Tajikistan last week, underscoring a rapidly deteriorating situation. However, even amid Taliban advances, Afghan government reassured the people that the current security situation is under control.
مقطعات خاص نیروهای ویژه که در افغانستان است فعلا اکثریتش رهبریتش در قندوز مستقر است از رهبری می شود هیچ نوع مشکل نیست صرف جز از خسته بودن و کسل بودن بعض سربازای ما یک دمه گرفتیم هیچ نوع مشکل نداریم اکثریت و سوالی ها پس ما پلان داریم پلان عملیاتی دوربرده داریم پیشوری داریم که تصفیه و تلاشی گرفتن و سوالی ها تمام قریجات پس به حساب پوست های خود انقریب فال میکنیم
The security situation in the country is getting bad to worse since mid-April, when US President Joe Biden announced the end of Afghanistan's forever war. The Taliban had made strides throughout the country. But their most significant gains has been in the northern half of the country, a traditional stronghold of the US allied warlords which helped defeat them in 2001. In the last week, the Taliban have overrun areas bordering five countries: Iran, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, China, and Pakistan. Meanwhile, the US military is living from its bases quietly. Last week, the Americans left Bagram Airfield, its key base in Afghanistan, in the dead of night without even notifying the Afghans, marking a symbolic end of the longest war in American history. America says that it has completed 90% of the troop withdrawal. The US military in Afghanistan will end entirely on August 31, despite new concerns about the possibility of a civil war. Afghanistan is not their problem anymore, President Joe Biden says. It is up to the Afghan people alone how they run the country.
We did not go to Afghanistan to nation build. And it's the right and the responsibility of the Afghan people alone to decide their future and how they want to run their country. I will not send another generation of Americans to war in Afghanistan with no reasonable expectation of achieving a different outcome.
Negotiations between Afghan government and the Taliban negotiators in Qatar have failed to make substantive progress in recent months, though the warring sides have been holding meetings in recent days. According to several reports, Pakistani terrorists are also fighting for the Taliban in Afghanistan. Some media outlets and political commentators in Afghanistan are blaming Islamabad for the current turmoil in their country, alleging that the Pakistani military and its intelligence agencies are backing the Taliban following the withdrawal of foreign troops, helping militants capture more territories.
Now we are joined by a geopolitical expert, Mr. Sushant Sareen, to discuss more about Afghanistan's current situation. Mr. Sareen, as US accelerates troop drawdown, Taliban has rampaged through the country. They claim to have captured 200 districts, including a provincial capital. What is your take on this developing crisis, and where do you see Afghanistan heading from here?
There are broadly two directions in which Afghanistan seems to be heading. One is that there is a fight back from the Afghan National Army and from the anti-Taliban forces. We are seeing some signs of regrouping, consolidation, fight back. Then Afghanistan faces a civil war. We don't know how long that will last. It could be prolonged. It could be maybe a few months, maybe a year or two, maybe much longer. On the other hand, if there is no fight back and the Taliban blitzkrieg continues, then you see what is most likely is that the Taliban will be able to establish their control over almost the entire of Afghanistan.
With US further advancing its backup date to 31st August, do you see other major powers coming to rescue?
No, I don't think anybody is going to come. I think a lot of countries which are concerned over what is likely to go down in Afghanistan will probably resort to hectic and even frenetic diplomacy. But beyond that, and maybe giving some assistance to the Afghan government, but beyond that, I don't see any other country in the world coming in to, you know, stall the Taliban advance, obstruct the Taliban advance, do something to give major weapon supplies to the Afghan government, or some kind of, as the Americans have popularized the term, over the horizon support to the Afghan government. I don't see much possibility of that.
After spending 20 years and trillions of dollars and sacrificing thousands of lives on the war in Afghanistan, what do you think the US has achieved?
The Americans came in, they resurrected the Afghan state. They reconstructed Afghanistan. At least they led the reconstruction effort. There were many other countries which were involved, but everybody was on the back of the Americans. There were many achievements which the Americans made in terms of education, setting up institutions, all of that. No doubt about it. So to disregard all the good that happened over the last 20 years, I think is wrong. And I think it's unfair. At the same time, the American failure has been that it fought the wrong war. It did not crack down on elements across the border in Pakistan from where support and sanctuary was being given to the Taliban. It somehow just dealt with the Pakistanis with kid gloves. Again, there were compulsions why they were forced to do that. The supply lines ran from Pakistan. There was no way they could supply Afghanistan through the northern route when it was active. It was not a viable proposition. The Americans never used their immense power to crack down on Pakistan. Second, they shifted their focus very early on in 2002-2003 to Iraq. And that war did not go down the way it was planned. It went horribly wrong. So that shifted the focus. And please remember that 2002-2003, when the focus shifted to Iraq, the Taliban were virtually decimated. Afghanistan, peace had returned, development was happening, a lot of money was pouring in. So maybe the Americans were justified in thinking that, you know, Afghanistan is settled, now we can move on to Iraq. But what we see is that once the focus shifted from Afghanistan to Iraq, the Taliban resurgence happened. This was what the Pakistanis were waiting for. And the Iraq war did not go according to plan. So, you know, those strategic mistakes were made.
Mr. Sareen, thank you so much for joining us. Moving on, India since independence has been facing the problem of terrorism. At various global platforms, New Delhi has highlighted countries' willingness to go beyond the talk on this serious issue and has always shown concern about the problems of evaluating counter-terrorism, particularly in South Asia. Participating in the UN General Assembly debate on adoption of resolution on 7th review of global counter-terrorism strategy, India asserted that the world should not return to the era of your terrorist and my terrorist, but fight the scourge collectively.
India is not only concerned about safety and security of people living in its own territory, but it always reiterates adopting and executing improved strategies to counter terrorism globally. In a recently held debate on adoption of resolution on 7th review of global counter terrorism strategy in the UN General Assembly, India reaffirmed its unwavering commitment to global efforts in fight against terrorism. India's permanent representative to the United Nations, Thirumurthy, said that the international community has acknowledged that the threat of terrorism is grave and universal and can only be defeated by collective efforts of all UN member states without any exception.
It was agreed that terrorism in all its forms and manifestation should be condemned. There cannot be any exception or justification for any act of terrorism, regardless of motivations behind such acts, and wherever, whenever, and by whomsoever committed. It was also recognized that the menace of terrorism cannot be and should not be associated with any religion, nationality, civilization, or ethnic group.
The eighth term as a non-permanent member of the UN Security Council was begun by India in the beginning of this year with the stated objective of raising its voice against terrorism. India cautioned the world that 20 years after the 9/11 terror attacks, there are attempts again to divide terrorism into different terminologies such as violent nationalism and right-wing extremism, asserting that the world should not return to the era of your terrorists and my terrorists, but fight this scourge collectively.
Let us not forget that before 9/11 happened, the world was divided into your terrorists or my terrorists. It is only after 9/11 that we accepted that terrorism in one part of the world can directly impact another part of the world, and we all came together to fight terrorism collectively. 20 years later, we are now seeing attempts to divide us once again by adopting new terminologies under the guise of emerging threats, such as racially and ethnically motivated violent extremism, violent nationalism, right-wing extremism, etc.
As a victim of cross-border terrorism for several decades, India has been at the forefront of the fight against terrorism and one of the major victims of terrorism. In its veiled attack at Pakistan, India asserted that it's time to call out those that deliberately violate global commitments by continuously supporting terrorists and extremists on their soil.
As a victim of cross-border terrorism for several decades, my country has been at the forefront of fight against terrorism and one of the major victims of terrorism. However, it is time to call out those that blatantly violate global commitments by harboring terrorists and terrorist entities, including those proscribed by the UN, by willfully giving moral, material, financial, and ideological support to these groups to foment terrorism and disrupt social harmony and peace. The international community needs to adopt a policy of zero tolerance towards terrorism. Our collective condemnation of terrorism must be loud, clear, and without any ambiguity.
Terrorism is a global phenomenon whose destructive potential and lethal reach is enhanced by breakneck technological innovations and ever-evolving digital landscape. Terrorists are using internet and social media for terrorist propaganda, radicalization and recruitment of cadre, misuse of new payment methods such as blockchain currencies, payment wallets, and crowdfunding platforms for terrorism financing. Domestic measures alone cannot deal with terrorism as long as some countries continue to provide safe havens for terrorists. Therefore, to be effective, the fight against terrorism must be long-term, sustained, and global. It must tackle not just the perpetrators of the acts, but also those who support and sponsor them.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Yeshi signing off on behalf of the entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.